Hi, I'm Fred Cohen. And so we're going to be, what was our subject? Does anybody see the posting of what the talk's about? All right, then it doesn't matter.
Science,
technology, money. I think what I was going to talk about was something you probably don't get much of, which is the business aspects of, you know, the intersection between cybersecurity, innovation, entrepreneurship, and the growth of business. And but I'll take your questions in any subject matter, and hopefully it won't be too boring. Just some background on how I know something about this. Most of my career has been spent in information protection, but at some point I started to invest in small attempted startups with relatively little success. Successful enough so that, you know, I now live in Pebble Beach, and so it's not bad. I wouldn't call it failure, but at the same time, I started to get interested in understanding, you know, how and why businesses get funded and why some companies succeed that I think it's ridiculous they shouldn't have a chance of succeeding, and other businesses that I think are really good ideas fail, and why, you know, why Google pays $1 billion to a startup that's 2 years old or something. Really? But, so they took your videos and put them online for free, and it's worth $2 billion. You know, that's impressive. Or Mike 10, I don't remember even what it sold for. YouTube, right? So I started to engage in more and more formalization of my understanding of angel investment, and ended up joining Keiretsu Fund, which is the largest angel investment, private angel investment group in the world. There are 2,500 investors in 46 chapters on three or so continents. Last year they invested a total of $80 million in 125 startups of various forms. And almost $750 million, almost three-quarters of a billion in investments since their inception. So they're looking at startups, trying to make them successful. And so the first question you ask is, why would you be an angel investor instead of a venture capitalist or something else in the supply chain? There's a whole supply chain. And so the answer becomes apparent when you look at the numbers. Venture returns are expected to be about 65% of the companies fail. That is, you know, they're investing $10 million or so per company, and 65% of them fail. And then, you know, 8% return more than 10 times what they put in. And apparently the venture investment in the United States is like $50 billion a year. So, you know, think about that. There's a lot of money there. Angel returns do much better. They do about 20% APR, so they give you a multiple of 10 in 10 years. So it's three times better than venture investment. And the question is why? And the answer is partly because they invest in fewer companies that fail. The same number of companies approximately have big successes. So the question is, you know, how is it that they invest in fewer failures? You know, are they smarter? Are they, you know, what is it that they do? And the answer is the correlation that we found that was found by the researchers is there's the angels. It's their money. They're not wealthy people typically. You know, they have a good living, a couple hundred thousand a year for, you know, over a period of years, or they have $1 million besides their permanent residence. They may be retired, right? A lot of retirement funds have that much money. When you retire, almost certainly, if you're reasonably successful, you'll have a couple $1 million in the bank to live on in your retirement. And at the current interest rate of, you know, what, 0.3%, you know, $1 million translates into like $30,000 a year, which is just about impossible to live on. But Social Security is going to be there as a safety net, right? So, you know, people that are smart and reasonably well off have to figure out how to make more money. You can try the stock market, and that's, you know, historically over time it does reasonably well. And then there's the angel investment. So what happens is people that are smart and that know something about business or know something about their particular area get together with other investors who know different things than them. and they work together to figure out which companies are worth funding. And then they help them, right? So it's not just that they give them money, they give them support, right? So if you have somebody that's a, that's a, has sold to Sears for most of their career, you guys remember what Sears is? Is Sears still around?
Yeah.
Right, so big, so they've sold to Sears all their lives, and there's a company out there that can be really successful if they can just sell to places like Sears. Maybe this investor can help them get into the Sears account because he knows the people and knows how it works and knows what it takes. And so he can help that company be successful, or she can help that company be successful. So the idea here is that the angels are putting in more than just money. They're putting in knowledge and experience and connections and all these things to help the business succeed. So the other side of this is, if you look at economic development, the investment space, you know, where do you get jobs, right? There's big companies. Big companies are responsible for what? Less than a third of the economy in the U.S.? So the other two-thirds come from small businesses, small and medium-sized businesses. And if you look at job growth, the job growth, comes from about 400,000 jobs a year in the U.S. come from angel investments. And the ones that are successful then become venture investments, but it's the same 400,000 jobs. So if you look at, recently, the economy is doing relatively well in terms of job growth, right? So you guys have a good chance of getting a job. I think last month a couple hundred thousand new jobs in the U.S. So, that's 1.2 million a year. So a third of it is from angel investment. So it's a very significant part of economic development. And then, of course, the problem is that because so many of them fail, if you put all your eggs in one basket as an angel investor, some of them will become rich and some of them will lose their nest egg and not be able to live in retirement. So they're starting to diversify across multiple companies. So they make a lot of bets and they work in groups. And that's how they become successful. By now I run the Pebble Beach chapter of Keiretsu Farm. So I'm now moving up in that infrastructure of investment and understanding more about how it works and how the whole process works. So this is fundamentals of how business development works. Now we're going to go online to the internet if we can.
Facebook.
Those believe there are two kinds of people in the world, and those who don't. Yes, yes, yes. A tautology. There are two kinds of people in the world, those that believe in tautologies. So, my longtime website is all.net, and I'm going to take you there for the other half of the picture. This is, I was working at Burton Group as an analyst for some years, analyzing, principal analyst for security and risk management strategies. That sounds good, doesn't it? Cool. Okay. So as an industry analyst, that means that everybody wants to talk to me because they think I'm going to write some sort of an article that's potentially good about them. That's not typically my way. I'm more of a critic. Every once in a while, I see something really good. But so over time, we developed models of how information protection works, and then subsequently and in my spare time, during and after and before, developed a model. I just want to walk you through the model of information protection. This gets you a sense of, this is the overarching model of information protection. So you start out typically in a business or any organization, any enterprise. The enterprise, it works by some method of working, right? So, for example, if you're in business, somebody sells something. They get money. The money pays, things, and they have expenses, and they have to get paid. You put money in, and you get product or service out, and there's things that have to get done, right? So if you can't communicate, you won't be able to receive the money in today's world, and you won't be able to deliver product in today's world, and you won't be able to perform the business functions necessary to accomplish that. So that's how the business works. So as a fundamental, the business, today businesses, almost all, depend heavily on information technology. So they can't succeed without some information stuff working. So once you understand the business, you can then understand how it depends on information technology, and in particular, for the information protection arena, how failures in information technology can produce failures in the business. So you know, there's all this stuff you learn about cybersecurity and whatever, but at the end of the day, nobody really cares if it has no effect. So the question is, what harm can come to the business? And when you talk about this, historically, CIA, confidentiality, integrity, and availability, is the thing that we were taught. And the reason you're probably taught about that is because the CIA was involved in cybersecurity. But the confidentiality is always the first thing. When you hear people talk about security and cybersecurity and information protection, you hear things like, they broke into the Pentagon war systems, but no classified information was taken. Okay, that's confidentiality. Now, when they say that, the first question I used to ask was, okay, so what did they corrupt to the point where none of our weapons work anymore? Because they didn't say anything about integrity or availability. All they said is, oh, no secrets really. So you know, of course, that critical infrastructure, any business that's manufacturing anything, confidentiality of the manufacturing process is almost never as important as the continuity of manufacturing it and the integrity of the manufacturing process, right? Because if you're making steel and the process isn't controlled right, you know, the process control system has a wrong temperature, a wrong pressure, you know, a chemical plant has the wrong mix of chemicals, then the output is not going to be right, it's not going to be the same quality level, and it may be, you know, somewhat destructive to the point of Bhopal, right, which killed some number of thousands of people from a chemical plant accident because the information technology in the control system didn't have the proper integrity, or maybe it wasn't available, maybe the, you know, because control systems run in a loop that has timing requirements. If you miss the timing requirements, you end up with positive instead of negative feedback. You guys know what happens when you get positive feedback, right? You get explosive growth, which is great in business, but not so good in technology. So generally speaking, integrity is really the most important thing that we tend to see, because if the answers are sufficiently wrong, it really doesn't matter that you get them. You know, you'd rather not have the answer than have, you know, okay, your payroll this month is $1 million and the CEO didn't get anything. Well, you might like it. So integrity, availability, confidentiality, use control is something we really think about, but control over who gets to use what and who gets to be in charge of what turns out to be awfully important. Think about weapons, right? You know, weapons are run by computers nowadays. And so if you're not in control of the use of the weapon, and somebody else is, that could be a bad thing. Accountability. Okay, so what, you know, who's responsible? What took place? What's the history of this? Transparency turns out in things like archives and records management for public records, the transparency of the record keeping process is fundamental to belief in the record keeping system and in the records. And when you think about modern society, the housing crisis stems from a variety of things, but one of the side effects was that they were taking people's homes and they couldn't establish who actually owned the home because the process they used to move money around put things in tranches, sold portions of the tranches to other people, retranched it, sold that to other people, so nobody actually owns those homes, right? That is, wherever the money is, there's no established ownership. So people went to court and swore in court that my bank owns this, when in fact they didn't have the basis to say that. In fact, it wasn't true. There's a chair over here in the corner, if you like.
I know, but this feels better.
If it feels good, do it.
Yeah.
So transparency is the thing that we need in order to believe that public records are what they're supposed to be, and that ownership of land, for example, is proper, that the, you know, the taxation process is working properly. And in archives and records management, this has been around for a long time, but in information protection, until a couple of years ago, nobody noticed it. It wasn't even in the list. We didn't even know we should address it. And custody is another one. For any legal process, you need chain of custody and the ability to demonstrate that somebody else didn't get a hold of it and modify it, and therefore you're found guilty of some crime or some civil loss because some digital record says you did it, but nobody actually knows that digital record is authentic and reliable. So custody helps to establish that. So at some point, oversight provides duties to protect. Okay, so what happens in an organization is, you know, when you sit there looking at your computer, you might think privacy is important, but maybe it's not. Maybe for this, so part of one of the organizations I run, Fearless Security, we don't take any PII in, period. Right, so we get all these contracts and say, you know, here's four pages of things you have to do for personally identifiable information. And we just scratch out all those lines and we put a line in the contract that says you will provide us with no personally identifiable information, period. We don't care. We don't need it to do our job. We don't want it. We don't have to protect it. So our duty to protect, that's just not in the list. Okay? So depending on what your duties are, that defines what you actually have to do. So if you have duties that you're supposed to do that you shouldn't be supposed to do, you're spending all sorts of time and money on things that are of no value to the business. And if you don't have defined duties, which is more common, you don't actually know what you're supposed to do. So what happens is management somewhere says, do this, but it's not a matter of policy. And different managers say to do different things, and now the whole company has different things going on in different places and it's inconsistent. And then you know you get sued and you have failures and so why did it fail? It failed because you know Jane said we have to do this and George said we don't. So some of us did it and some of us didn't and you know it didn't work right. From there, once you know what your duties are, you go through the risk management process and make decisions about what to protect, how well. Security management, this is about people, right? There's a big feedback system. Anybody that's have you had courses in controls, control systems? Yes, some of you at least. So this is a control system. It's a human control system, right? The people in charge, they send out actions. Communication is their methodology for sending out actions. And they observe results from whatever gets communicated back to them. And their job is to control these different aspects of the process to assure that the process that operates this protective scheme works as it's supposed to, and to adapt it and fix things that break. You have the protection objectives. You have something called, this is part of what I call control architecture. For example, very few people in your cybersecurity class talk about access facilitation. Right? You keep talking about access control, keeping people out, right? Well, if availability is important, then you have to make sure people can get in. It's more important than keeping them out, right? Because, you know, gee, if we can't get in, you know, the car will crash, right? Somehow the system that controls the car has to get access to the parts of the car it controls. So if your access controls prevent the system that's controlling the car from doing its control, then you're not going to be able to steer. So it's access facilitation that's in many cases more important than access limitation. So it's not just about stopping things that you think are bad, it's about assuring that the good things happen. And that's part of the role of information protection that's usually ignored in classes and elsewhere, it's not just classes. And then the whole protection process, interesting result. There's a study done every year, Computer Security Institute used to do the study. Now Verizon has a study, an annual study of computer security stuff, which you'd be well advised to read. And so if you go and look at that study, a couple years ago, they discovered that something like 90% of all the protection failures associated with the leaking of information that shouldn't have gotten out was from information within systems that weren't in their inventory or information that wasn't in their inventory. So they just didn't know that the system or the information was there, and that's why they didn't protect it. So you can get rid of 90% of the problem by having inventory, a good inventory. So how long has an inventory system been around? Right? Inventory has been part of business and part of accounting for hundreds of years, at least 400, 500, 600 years. So we just don't do inventory. Notice this, in computers we don't do inventory. Well, how do you know what's there if you don't do inventory? And if you have different protection requirements for different things, how do you protect them properly if you don't know what they are or that they're there? So it's a simple thing, doing inventory, but oops, we forgot about it. Workflow is another important aspect. That is, in order to do anything systematically in an organization, you need to have a process by which it gets done, and you need a system to make sure the process works as it's supposed to, or if it starts to fail, it compensates for the failure before the big bad consequences happen. Again, simple, normal operating stuff. Eventually you get down to the stuff that you're used to, right? That is the stuff that touches the content. You know, you get data at rest and use and in motion. Deter, prevent, detect, react, adapt to events that take place. There are business people, system, and data life cycles that you have to handle. That's why, you know, if you're not handling life cycles properly, you throw out that disk and don't bother to properly clean it, and then they get all the data. People life cycles, you know, so you your information technology system helps support who gets assigned to what job, and you end up with a pregnant woman in a chemical plant that has things that cause harm to the baby, right? Because your information technology that's supposed to support controlling the possible assignments doesn't keep track of it, and your human system, the manager, that depends on that system, you know, doesn't realize what the rules are, okay? So that's, you know, just purely a people life cycle issue. And then there's the who, what, where, why, when, how stuff. By the way, if you look at information protection, does anybody here know of any example of an information protection scheme that addresses why? We control who, right? What, right? And who can access what, where, when, how they can do it, but we don't do why. But why is the reason all this stuff happens? So the fundamental thing that we really need to understand is the thing we don't do, and by the way, computers are really bad at answering the question why. Most everything we do doesn't address the why. So we might think about that one. So then you have protective mechanisms that basically get in touch with the people or the data, perception, behavior, structure, and content. So this is the overarching structure I'll use to talk about information protection. You've seen the business notion of how you grow businesses. So the question is, you know, if society is going to change, it's not going to change because some great theoretical idea comes along and somebody says, oh cool, I'll use this theoretical idea, this new kind of encryption or this new access control or this thingamabob that's fabulous at doing the whatchamacallit, whatever the whatchamacallit is that we need done, we've got a thingamabob that does it. That has no effect on society. Yes, I may use my thingamabob to take care of the whatchamacallit. Oh, I'm sorry, was it the whatchamacallit thingamabob? I might be able to do that in my lab and in my computers in my house or something, but that's not going to change the world. Right? We have, what, 7 billion people in the world? There are 1.4 billion cell phones in China. They're smartphones, all of them. 1.5 billion smartphones in China. In the US, there are more, I believe there are more smartphones and pad computers than there are people. Okay, you talk about the Internet of Things, because, you know, I need to have a computer for my shoelaces. Because I could never figure out that thing that comes after, because there's some reason I need a computer on my shoelace. So we connect all this stuff together, right? And guess what you get? So the problem is, if I invent the most marvelous thing for controlling the access to my shoelaces, that's not going to save the world. So the problem we have is enormous, right? We have all of these interdependencies, right? We all depend on critical infrastructures, and everything we do depends on many things that depend on other things that depend on other things and so forth in the information technology arena. So something that's going to have an effect is going to have an effect across the whole ecosystem. So how do you get it to scale? Brilliant idea. Okay, great, you had a brilliant idea. How are you going to get it to work in enough systems in enough places to actually have an effect on the world? And the ideas. Okay, simple question. How do you get it? How do you get it? Whatever the thing is, how are you going to get it?
Sorry, what?
Right, you have a thingamabob that's going to do a whatchamacallit for you, yeah. And you need it desperately.
Yeah.
So does everybody else in the world. We got billions of devices that need it. How are you going to get it in your devices? How do you get anything in your phone now?
Install it from somewhere else.
So you're gonna buy it.
Yeah.
And whether you buy it by having advertisements come at you because somebody else paid for it, or you buy it with money out of your pocket, you gotta buy it. So if you're gonna buy it, they're gonna sell it, if they're going to sell it, you're going to buy it, somebody's going to have to make it, something tells me there's going to be a business involved. So the way you take great idea and turn it into change the world is through building a business. If you think you're going to count on the government doing it, forget it. It ain't going to happen. And the reason I say that, let's see, the government right now is trying to, the U.S. government right now is trying to gain more access to more people's information under the name of, what is it now, terrorism, yes. Terrorism. You should be afraid, so give me your data, right? The Chinese government has no such problem. They just say, give me your data, you're already afraid. But you know, every government around the world wants access to all the data. In fact, they want access to everybody else's data, but they don't want everybody else to have access to their data, right? So they're all in competition with each other to get your data. But some of them decided to share it. They just gave up on keeping it. All right, now we're a group. NATO's a group. We're going to share it all except the stuff we don't share. You know, because in politics, there are no friends. There are allies. Right? So you cooperate with each other in a limited way. So business is the only path, the only realistic path, by which that new thing, there are a couple chairs over here if you're interested. That's the only path by which new things get into the hands of the billions of people and the tens of billions, moving on hundreds of billions of things that are information related. So I want to tell you a little bit about, I was just at the RSA conference. Does anybody know what the RSA conference is? If you know, raise your hand. Great, tell me what the RSA, tell them what the RSA conference is.
It's a security conference where they give a lot of talks on security related things, and there's a lot of panels with professionals and they talk about current events and security.
There you go, that's a pretty good description. You missed the one thing at the RSA conference that is maybe most important, and that is there are vendors and vendor booths. I think there are on the order of 500 or more vendors that were at the RSA this year. And I visited every booth, yes?
Wasn't there some sort of security problem at the RSA conference this year?
Who cares?
Okay. They're not, right?
I mean, wasn't there a security problem in this room today? Right?
Yeah, but it's not, we're not, oh, okay, yeah.
A security. Yeah, there's security problems everywhere all the time. Okay. Without the consequences, nobody cares. So if there was a consequence of the RSA, and you wanted to tell me about it, I'd be interested, but, you know, so what? You know, it's like, oh, my shoelace was untied. We have a security problem. It's a health and safety problem. Somebody could have been injured, but I tied my shoe and walked on, so. Well, that, think about it. It's the same thing, right? We hear about all these cybersecurity problems. Oh my God, there's a vulnerability in Squash version 7.3 that's being deployed to 50,000 computers in the next 6 weeks. Okay, first of all, it'll never get deployed to those computers because in the next 6 weeks somebody will stop it, so it'll only get deployed to some of them. But second of all, what, 50,000 computers? What's the percentage of the population? Right? There's tens of billions of devices. So that's, you know, a billion is 10 to the 9th, so, you know, 10 to the 10th, so 50 into 10 to the 10th is, you know, 2 times 10 to the 8th, right? So 1 in 100 million, or, you know, it's ridiculous, it's unimportant. Who cares? I mean, we would care if it was the system that accidentally or intentionally launched a nuclear weapon and blew some, you know, killed a bunch of people, but that's not what it was, apparently. It was more like my shoelace computer. So nobody cares, and I didn't trip because I retied my shoelace. That's what it is. The shoelace computer beeps if your shoelace is untied. And it's connected to the internet so they can update it for new shoelace tying algorithms. But you can remotely access it, and it has the ability to untie your shoe at the wrong time. So when you're not looking, it can detect that, untie your shoe and make you trip up. And that's the security vulnerability with the shoelace. So if you look at the vendor booths, which I do, every year I walk through and I look at every vendor booth, I go to every vendor booth, and invariably you have the vendor booth that says no false positives for some detection. And, you know, so I guess I'm just an old curmudgeon, but I've done this for a long time, so I guess I was a young curmudgeon. So I say, no false positives, really? What have you done to do that? Because that's, you know, we believe it's theoretically impossible. But tell me what you did, and they say, well, and I say, that produces false positives. Now, two possibilities occur. One of them is that the person, well, three. One of them is the person there at the booth doesn't know anything and refers you to somebody else at the booth that knows more. So that, we'll just discount that one, because you get to the person who knows more. And either they're a businessman or an engineer. If they're an engineer, they'll, you know, once you disabuse them of that by giving them five or six examples of things that will produce false positives and they agree to it, and they say, yeah, my boss said it has to say that. I said, where's your boss? I'm not kidding. I did this at the RSA conference. There were three or four of these booths. Where's your boss? Point me to the boss. I say to the boss, it says no false positives. It's not true. Everybody at this conference is not stupid. When they see no false positives, they're not going to buy it from you because they know it's not true. You need to change it. Right? Now, I have a badge that says press at the RSA, which you would think means I'm with the press. But I'm not. I'm an analyst, right? I'm an analyst, so I analyze the industry and I write stuff up. I write an article. Oh, so if you go to all.net, let's just go back. By the way, if you have a default homepage, all.net. So I write these little articles. I mean, here's the what's new in cybersecurity at the RSA. This the second article in March of this year, right? And so you can, you know, read all about it in these articles and see what I've been thinking for the last 25 or 30 years on a month-to-month basis, and they're all up there along with the technical articles. You're welcome to read them. There's a chair right here.
Okay.
Just saying. So you know, you walk around and you see all these booths. So the question is, what's new at the RSA? And so I try to get a sense of what's new. Generally, the answer is not much. And in that sense, this year did not disappoint. So one of the challenges we have is there's really nothing very new in cybersecurity. In fact, there probably never is.
Probably.
I'm always looking, right? I mean, I go to every booth, and every once in a while, somebody says something interesting. And I listen to it. So when there's something interesting, I make note of it. And I have a couple of notes on some interesting things in that article you might look at. So one of the things that I did maybe in so it's 15, 16, 17 years ago, a bunch of years ago, is I studied attacks, methods of attack, and methods of defense, and threats. And so I made a list. And, you know, they're all clickable. It's all free. So induced stress failures, right? So you scroll down and it tells you about what they are, something about the complexity of dealing with them. So I did this with the notion that, you know, is there anything really changing in information protection? And the answer is, who wants to guess? No. Right. No.
Nah.
There's really nothing new in information protection. There's minor improvements, evolution, okay? But for the most part, nothing is changing. Nothing has changed in the last 15 or 20 years. Every once in a while, somebody asks me about computer viruses, and I say, nothing new since 1992. And, you know, I peer-reviewed journal articles. There's all sorts of incremental, you know, adaptations and improvements. So things are getting better, but it's nothing new. There's no breakthroughs. Okay? So the question is, you know, that I ask, if I'm going to remember, the game here is if you're going to improve things, you need a business to take an idea and deploy it to lots and lots of people and lots of systems. Otherwise, the world's not going to improve. Now, I just want to point out, who here thinks they're better off today than they were 5 years ago? Gee, guess what? Everybody. You know, most of you aren't old enough to know what it was like before you always had a smartphone with you. But, you know, it wasn't that long ago that you went and found a phone booth to make a phone call. And you put in, you know, dimes and quarters. And, you know, went da-ding, 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 and the operator said, not enough cash, I'm sorry, you can't continue talking past 2 minutes. on your you know, call to tell somebody, you know, we had fax machines. I was doing international business when fax machines became popular. And the fax machine was revolutionary. I could send a fax to Europe If I got up early in the morning, I could send a fax to Europe, somebody could get it in Europe, read it, figure out their answer, write in the answer, print it out, put it in the fax machine, send it back to me, and I could have two cycles of communications per day with somebody in Europe, which was revolutionary compared to sending physical envelope-filled pieces of paper through the mails, which was what, you know, a couple years before would have took. So it went from, you know, a week per exchange to two exchanges per day to email, okay? And so, you know, this change in the world, everything's getting better. It really is. There's some problem here. Cybersecurity, we keep hearing all the terrible, horrible, bad things, and it's getting worse and worse and worse. Terrorism, all the horrible things going on in the world, and it's getting worse and worse. But on the whole, everybody you know, their life is better. They live longer, healthier, happier, higher quality food, better air, better water in the United States. Okay? Not in Flint, Michigan. Not in Delhi, India. They had a couple weeks ago somebody, like a caste that was being treated unfairly because they weren't getting advantages for jobs because they were too high in the caste system to be compensated, decided to blow up a water main that served half of Delhi. This being, what, population 15, 20 million people? So, you know, 10 million people without water. How long can you live without water? How long?
3 days.
3 days, you're really lucky to get 3 days out of it. 2 or 3 days without water, right? 2 or 3 minutes without air, 2 or 3 days without water, 2 or 3 weeks without food, right? So you got, what, 10 million people without water. You know, that's a problem, right? But we don't have that big problem here. Let them drink sparkling water. Sorry. I forgot to turn on the microphone.
Oh, that's all right.
I'm sorry. Well, you just have a video. Oh, is that record too?
Yeah.
Oh, cool. Because I talk loud.
Okay.
All right. So the challenge is, you know, what emerging thing is showing up that's going to change the world for the better in cybersecurity? Recognizing the world's getting better all on its own, and cybersecurity is apparently getting worse on its own, right? Because now that we all know how vulnerable all this crap is, and now that this was on the internet and available for all to see, threats and attacks and defenses, lists of them, for, you know, 15, 20 years now. And it was all based on published work before that, if you wanted to look it up. People are starting to use about a third of it now. So the attack methods, people are using about a third of it. The defense methods, people are using about a third of it. And every few years, another one of them pops up and somebody starts using this method. And that's new. It's new and improved. It's not just new, it's new and improved. And they start to sell it, and they start to bring it into market. Okay? So they bring it to the RSA and other such places. They get some friends and family to give them some money. They have an idea. They start developing some hardware, software, whatever they develop. They try to bring it to market, but you can't sell it to very many people on your own, because unless you're, you know, a Rockefeller or, you know, somebody like that, you don't have an extra $1 billion to start up a business that's going to scale. So they start with little money. They get the investors. They convince investors. The investors start to put in money. They start to scale it. But at the end, they can't scale it on their own. Almost no company starts out, goes public, and ends up with 1 billion customers. Almost universally, you get to some level and you sell it to a giant monster company, and then they deploy it to everybody else because they have the means to do that. It takes, you know, 20 years to develop the capacity to sell things to 1 billion people. So you sell it to another business, and then they sell it to those 1 billion people, and you make a pile of money, and you walk away, you know, a multi-multi-millionaire, and the investors walk away with multi-multi-thousandaire, you know, more than they had before, and everybody's happy. So the question is, what in cybersecurity is going to do that? So there are a couple of interesting things I saw at the RSA this year, and I thought I would share them with you. One of the interesting ones is the fusion of big data with cybersecurity. So does anybody know what big data is? What's big data?
It's a lot of data.
Compared to what?
It's like our human capacity to analyze.
Beyond the human capacity to analyze, so that's like 100.
Wow.
All right, 1,000, 10,000.
It's a lot.
A lot. Okay. So,
more
so
medium data.
So. Yeah, exactly. Medium-sized data, and then there's a big data. And if you're really hungry, you need a big data.
Get a medium rare.
Yeah, medium rare. Yeah. It is rare to have medium data. So let me just ask you, how many pieces of data constitutes big data? What's the biggest data you've ever worked on? Anybody work on a problem with that, say 100,000 things? Raise your hand if you worked on something that had 100,000 different data elements in it. A couple of you? All right, 1,000,000, more than 1,000,000. Okay, 10,000,000. 10,000,000? 10,000,000. 100,000,000.
It's like a bid.
Sorry?
I said it's like a bid.
10. So nobody's gotten over 100,000,000. Okay, so I was on a forensics gig in the last couple of years that had 15 trillion pieces of semi-structured, semi-unstructured data involved. So, That would be big data, right? At least it's bigger than your data. So let's say that's big data. So the first question you have when you get that much data for a security problem is, you know, so where exactly is these 15 trillion records? Right? Because somehow, even when you think about it, they exist somewhere. You have to get them as input to whatever you're going to do. Right? So you need enough storage to store them, you need enough bandwidth to get them to somewhere, you need enough computational power to process them through whatever algorithm you're going to use, you need enough output to be able to get out the results, and you need enough storage or some other mechanism to handle the output and do something with it. Okay? So there are big problems with big data, and a lot of the work on big data has to do with algorithms. Right? So what they're doing a lot is graph theory. So they have graph theory approaches to handling big data. So instead of handling, you know, databases with enormous numbers of rows, you know, a couple trillion rows, and having to go through it sequentially or some sort of a B-tree to search it, they spread it out over you know, millions and millions of computers that are inexpensive, and they try and form graphs. So they form partial graphs, and then they do connections between the graphs, and there's a lot of theoretical work to figure out what can connect to where, how, and how to optimize whatever part of the process. So, the results from graph theory, starting largely by the efforts put forth in DARPA over the last, say, 10 or so years, starting to look at things like social media analysis, looking at psychographic information, psychological profiling, word counts, the different usage of words, trying to get things like mood out of, you know, Twitter tweets. Are they tweets? Twitter has tweets? Twitter tweets. And so forth. So they're trying to measure mood. So people are unhappy. A large number of people are unhappy. A lot of people are really unhappy. There's going to be a riot. Okay? So the security world is starting to say, we can use big data for security. So any idea about how you can use big data for security?
Analyzing anomalies.
That's too generic. What gives it give you?
Connect people's interactions with, say, your server's website.
Okay, I'm going to go back to my picture about the structure of information protection, right? So consequence, right? The issue here is that failures in information technology produce potentially serious negative consequences. Protective measures and the system that makes those measures effective are what mitigate those potentially serious negative consequences, hopefully before they occur. Okay? So what consequence in the information arena justifies big data? Right? Remember, we're going to be spending millions, tens of millions, hundreds of millions of dollars on infrastructure, storage, high-speed communications, lots and lots of parallel processors, taking data from all sorts of places, feeding them to all sorts of places. It's going to cost enormous sums of money to do this. What is the consequence that we're mitigating by doing this?
Losing credit card numbers or social security numbers?
Losing credit cards. So the question is, do you need that big analysis to detect the loss of credit cards? And there's two issues here, okay? I'll get to the second issue. So the first question is, do you need all this big computation to control the loss of credit card numbers? Right, what will it do for you?
Well,
How do you plan to use the big data capabilities?
To protect the from outside sources.
It's a generic term. Specifically, what's it going to do? Remember, you're convincing me to invest, you know, $10 million in your business, and it's going to turn into a multi-billion dollar business that's going to be worth some big company having and spreading all over the world. Right? So what's the big idea? Anybody have any sense of what it is? What's the consequence? What consequence could justify that in cybersecurity? Okay, we talked about this before. How about terrorism? The big bad fear factor. The big bad fear factor. Terrorism. If I use terrorism as the excuse, I'm sorry, as the reason, the rationale, the rational reason. Okay, we'll call it a rational reason. We'll use terrorism, so we're going to stop terrorism, and we want to sell these big computers, because that's got to be expensive, or we can't make that much money on it. I've just got to use my new algorithm, of graph algorithm, which I've been working on for the last 10 years. I got some guy from a university that's smart. So, okay, so now what am I going to do? How am I going to use that graph algorithm with all this expensive hardware to solve terrorism, which is sufficiently frightening to make it worth whoever it is spending whatever it is to do it? What do you think? What do you got? What's going to stop terrorism?
Really good body scanners?
Probably not, because realistically, we're going to deploy body scanners. The day may come, right? It's not a bad idea, right? Imagine we get a body scanner, it's just, very small, and we can just plant them all over the place in every building, and they locally automatically do this analysis and figure out who has what kind of weapon, and maybe their brain state, which is a really good scanner, figure out their brain state, and if they seem like they're getting violent, we can, anticipate the crime, and pre-crime and analyze them and arrest them before they shoot anybody, right? But that's not big data. That's local small data. So you must be reading the news.
Facial recognition.
Oh, facial recognition. There you go. That's a good one, right? So we have, along the streets, we're taking pictures of everybody everywhere. We recognize their faces. We have some local algorithms to extract the features, transmit it to a big central database where we have all the faces of everybody that's good and bad. Well, that's all a problem, but we'll do it anyway. Recall, rationality is not the issue. It's saleability. So we're gonna have it in cameras. We're gonna sell millions of cameras. The infrastructure to support pulling all that data from all those cameras to big central sites, somewhere in Colorado, Nevada, or West Virginia. We'll put them in West Virginia where that big FBI center is, and have another one in Utah where they have a big data center. All right, so we'll pull it all in there. We'll use enormous data to watch every face everywhere and track where everybody is all the time, and detect bad guys. Right? That could work, right? Okay, so is that a good idea? No. Why is that not a good idea?
It's a lot of reasons. It's kind of an invasion of privacy, plus there's just so many, you don't have everybody's face in a record somewhere to figure out.
Well, we will soon.
and you don't always know who the terrorists are going to be before they become terrorists. So it's hard to have that database.
So you find the bad guys, but how fast are you going to act on this one?
False positives.
But there are all sorts of problems with the technology.
What if you identify somebody as a terrorist and they're not actually?
Yeah.
We have a few in Guantanamo Bay. They've been released over time.
It's true, though.
They've been released over time after it's been clearly identified that there's no relationship between them and terrorism. 5-10 years. So, what's it called when you take somebody, when the FBI takes somebody not on American soil? No, extradition would be the other process.
I mean, so you identify them, how are you going to prevent them, though?
You go arrest them. You pick them up, put them in somewhere.
What if it's too late, though?
What?
Nothing.
You're right to recognize there's a whole problem here. But the question is, so what are you going to use the big data for? That is an example of an application of big data that is trying to be put in place, one way or the other, in the United States and throughout the world. London, more cameras per square meter, I think, than anywhere in the world. My understanding is that London you were always under surveillance by two cameras when you were in public space. Okay? So yeah, that's a big data example. What's another big data example?
Natural language processing to stop human trafficking.
Well, the consequence is going to be terrorism, because that's the thing that justifies spending this year. If there was a war somewhere, North Korea is going to do it. It's to prevent North Korea from targeting us with nuclear weapons. There you go. Okay. There has to be a big bad consequence, or you can't sell fear. Right? So what was the idea?
I was going to try to sell it on stopping human trafficking with natural language processing of sites like Craigslist and other.
Yeah, but you're missing the big opportunity. The big opportunity is to listen to all conversations on all communications, voice over IP, mm-hmm. and all the other wireless everything, gather it all, suck it all in, and turn it into text, and then analyze the text for psychological factors indicative of somebody or correlated with somebody that might do bad things. Oh wait, we already have that. So it's too late. There are actually systems. It's been, at least according to the media, published that there are systems that do this. And if you look at the Snowden stuff, we apparently are listening to all those phone calls and already doing some of that natural language. But yeah, that's a big application for big data and security. Okay, so if you look across this space, at the RSA, there were maybe 5-10 companies talking about big data used for security. And they were doing just the things that you talked about. They're growing companies that potentially can grow very big by providing big data analysis and solutions to anomaly detection across enormous networks, listening to all the voice and figuring out what everybody said to each other and keeping a record of everything everybody said to each other everywhere and where they are at every point in time, so that if something bad happens, we can track them back. Okay? But this isn't really big data. Because the next thing in big data, what's the next thing in big data that's going to make all this stuff pale by comparison? What's the next big technology in terms of enormous processing power in computing?
Quantum.
Got it. Quantum. So there are companies that are doing quantum computing, and you look it up, and they can now do quantum computing approximately the same speed as we can do non-quantum parallel processing. But theoretically, they can do much better. All they need is more money.
I love the money.
They just need a lot more money for another 5 or 10 years, getting up into the billions of dollars, and they're going to be able to do quantum, and it might succeed. And then we'll have incredibly enormous processing capacity. But what problem are we going to be solving in security? What is the security problem where the solution lies?
The other countries that you're going against have faster processing speed than you do.
So it's about who has the faster processing with, right? Computational leverage. So it's actually not just who has the more processing power, it's who has the better algorithms.
Cryptography
will break all the crypto. There you go. Break all the crypto, then the crypto gets bigger keys. So it's about the back and forth, right? By the way, wouldn't it be nice if we had something where there was an actual advantage to the defendant? Instead of the tit-for-tat game we keep playing where we keep escalating each side, wouldn't it be nice to have something so strong in the defense that the other side wouldn't work? All right, let me tell you about the other breakthrough in information protection of the RSA, what I consider to be the other big move that's occurring. Okay? There are increasingly more, better, expanding, more effective in the market companies at security awareness. Okay, so why is that a breakthrough? Why is that a super good business? What does it do for the world?
What do you mean by security awareness?
I mean, I was just going to say, like, humans are usually like the easiest point of failure system, so education is going to fix a lot of problems.
Like, right. There's nothing in security that's a problem that we don't know how to solve. Every methodology of attack that exists, there is a successful methodology of defense. Every single one. You cannot identify an attack methodology where there isn't an existing defense methodology that can defeat it or at least reduce the consequences and the frequency of those consequences to the point where it doesn't matter. The problem is, we don't do it. We don't need any new technologies in security, not the technical end of it. What we need is people that, you know, first of all, people that do the right thing, right? So when you get the spam email, instead of clicking on the, oh, she loves me from Bulgaria, or the, I've been declared a prince, right? Or, yes, I'm a love machine, whatever it is, right? Instead of clicking on that button, they say, and they teach you this in counterintelligence, they teach you this, right? They say, look in the mirror, okay? Look in the mirror, you're balding, you're not that pretty, you're getting older, you're fat. When that young girl approaches you and says, oh, you're the most wonderful thing in the world, and you're in a foreign country and you have a security clearance, guess what? Almost certainly this is not the love affair you've been missing all your life. Right? It's an elicitation attempt, right? So just the awareness of that is how you hope to prevent people from, now, it doesn't always work, right? People have had this training. What's the name? There was a general that is no longer working for the United States military, who leaked secrets to a woman who was a member of the press. Remember that, the last couple of years? What was the name? Good. This should be the fate of everybody that does something foolish like this, is nobody remembers them. But we should remember the story, okay? And we should teach the story to our children and their children, right? Think of it, you know, when you get, I'll call it indoctrinated for lack of a better word, but when you get involved in religion, almost invariably any successful religion will say, you need to do this and you need to teach your children to do this, and they need to teach their children, because otherwise the religion dies out, you know, because you didn't teach your kids and they didn't teach their kids, so we all forgot it. So it's the necessary condition of reproduction that whatever method it's going to survive reproduces. So the reproduction is that you teach it to your kids and they teach it to their kids. Okay? So that's the reproduction. By the way, that's called a meme, the reproduction of the meme, which may sound familiar to anybody who studies computer viruses. Their mechanism is reproduction, which may be familiar to anybody that studies biological systems. The means of reproduction is what creates that survival thing, because anybody that doesn't reproduce, that's it, you're done. Any biological mechanism that never reproduces, it's not in the world anymore, right? It's gone. So this reproductive notion of these memes. So what we need to do is create the memes that reproduce throughout our society so that we understand what to do. And we do that by telling stories and by having, there are different, a lot of different methods for training and awareness. So there are companies that are starting to be bigger and bigger at training and awareness. They're getting pushed into more companies more often. They're starting to learn how often you have to retrain somebody.